All right. Hello and welcome to the 111th episode of the Geekverse podcast. I am your host, Dylan Muss.
I'm Tyler Briggs.
I'm Reuben Olson.
I am the Don't Send Rabbits to Kill a Fox Taylor Field.
Yes. Nice. And we have a very special guest, a longtime friend of the show.
I am her rebellious blue streaks in her weird hair.
He has no name. No name.
You can abbreviate
if
that.
If we refer to someone as McCall, we're probably talking about that guy, but you don't really know for sure. As you've seen by the title, this is our Ghost in the Shell review. We all just got back. You guys were at a different theater. I was, like, looking for you the whole time.
I didn't know.
I thought you were coming to the West Kelowna one, too, but I guess you wanted to see that 3D.
Well, no, but 3D was the only showing they had.
I know, that's why we did. We're like, it's worth it to drive an extra 15 minutes just to not have to see it.
Can you imagine that flashlight?
Oh, man, it was brutal.
In 3D, though.
No, the colors at the beginning when they're all flashing.
Yeah. I had to look away.
I had to take my glasses off at that point.
Anyway, yes, Ghost in the Shell review. I think quickly, just... like our history of Ghost in the Shell. This is my first Ghost in the Shell experience, so I'm a sorry soul. But how about you, Tyler?
I watched it at like 2 in the morning, the original film only.
Yeah.
So I don't remember all of it like perfectly, but before this, I had pretty good experience with it.
I've seen the original movies, Standalone Complex and its sequel, but I have not seen Arise.
What is Arise?
Like four movies to Arise.
Yeah.
Oh,
okay. It's basically another like anime if you combine all of them.
Okay. Taylor, have you seen?
I have had no experience. Like the trailer was my first like emotional experience.
Don't give yourself that much credit. And then McCall, you've seen?
I have seen both of the original movies and Standalone Complexes. I haven't seen Arise either.
Is Arise just, it has a bad rap, I'm guessing?
We just won't get into Arise.
Like, I feel like the further down you go in the continuity, and this is total bias talking, like, the more bad it is.
And then it takes you to 2017, and we're left with this one?
I mean, like, it's not even, like, it's not connected to anything. Like,
yeah. Okay, well, we'll do our quick spoiler-free just overview. We'll start with you, Tyler. What'd you think overall?
Overall, wasn't that great. It was pretty bad, I think some of you guys agree with me at least. It had a lot of money, so the visuals were pretty nice at some times, but other than that, I mean, I don't know, I wouldn't go see it in theaters again.
Would you see it in non-theaters again?
Probably not.
That's not good.
Yeah, not a movie you need to see this year.
I thought it was okay, you know, visually it was amazing.
Mm-hmm.
As far as being Ghost in the Shell goes, I mean, I guess it's kind of its own thing. I don't want to look at it as a part of the animeverse at all. But, you know, I would watch it again, not in theaters, maybe on Blu-ray when that comes out, see what some of the extras are. Although I also like Scarlett Johansson, so I'm kind of biased for that.
Fair enough. Taylor? Not a good start for a Taylor overview.
Yeah,
I mean... You know, I definitely agree with Ruben. Like, you know, it was definitely visually, it was amazing. There were certain parts that left me kind of confused, but I think the confusion wasn't because I didn't understand what was going on, or maybe it was, because I was confused. I'm still trying to figure that out, but I kind of I caught the general gist of what was going on, and I didn't mind it. I thought it was pretty good. It sets me up to kind of want to watch the anime.
Cool.
Yeah.
Cool.
Like, the visuals were obviously really, really good. I did feel like on the theater screen, were we getting 40K, you know, or 4K, you know, that streaming gold number, because it looked really terrible, some of the CGI, at times.
Yeah.
I felt like when the cars were going, some of it looked really terrible.
Oh, there's one scene that was
that
awful.
Story was just awful, and, lots of it was not even sensical to itself. So, I wouldn't go see it again. I might watch it at home just to look at the CGI some more because I do really like how they interpreted, like, the universe, but, like, nothing else.
Fair enough. As for myself, I pretty much just agree with you guys. I think it looked great. I actually really liked the music to it and, like, the sound effects in general. I thought it just looked and sounded really good. But as for the story, I was, like, into the story for, like, maybe a 20-minute period, like, right in the middle. But then... it died off right after that. I just felt like it was kind of lazy, and most of the characters, I just, like, didn't care for them at all when they were on screen. I was like, just get off. When that one lady died, that's a spoiler already, but when there's one person that dies, and I was, like, I'm glad that they're off this movie, and I don't have to see them anymore, so. Yeah, it wasn't very good. I probably won't see this again. In theaters, is probably the worst movie I've seen this year, I would say. I'd say that's pretty fair.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's all I got for an overview. What do you guys want to jump into first?
Let's jump into the visuals, because that's something we've all brought up.
Yeah, sure. And?
Well, you know, visually, they had a pretty big budget for it, I'd say. And going right to the CGI, because I just want to say that the visuals were perfect. It captured the atmosphere. There were a lot of moments in the movie where I kind of almost felt creeped out by some of the androids and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
But then when it came down to it in the action scenes, there were a few moments where the CGI was just bad. Like, it's like they took a 3D model of the actor and animated it. Like, no motion capture or anything like that. Okay. Just had an animator go at it.
Yeah, definitely.
And, like, run up a wall or something. And it's like, whoa, that's not happening yeah. in the movie. I'm seeing, like, this person running up a wall by themselves. Everything else is just gone now. Okay, and then it ends, and it's back to being amazing visuals again.
Yeah. I think that, yeah, the best part was, like, the atmospheric kind of visuals, like, yeah. the giant holograms in the cities and just everything going on yeah. in that sense was very good. Yeah, and then, like, yeah, a lot of Scarlett Johansson, like, even just moving her arm sometimes, it's just, like, that looks really strange. Like, that's not her arm.
They definitely made her look a little autistic sometimes, yeah. so things like that. And, yeah, the cyberpunk aesthetic that all of the other media for Ghost in the Shell has, mm-hmm. I feel like this movie captured it really well. Yeah. Like, all of the cities and stuff, I thought they were really good.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I kind of like the color scheme. Like, it was very just, like, it was very white and then just, like, bright colors. I don't know. I just felt like it was kind of like an upbeat sort of color scheme, like, atmosphere, too. See, I don't really know.
That was the atmosphere it really had going for it, was in the cities during the daytime. There's mm-hmm. there's bright colors everywhere. It's like neon city, right?
Mm-hmm.
But then you go down to, like, the slums or inside a bar, and it's just dark, depressing fog, and there's, like, cyber, like, lights everywhere, too, and it mm-hmm. just feels like you're in some kind of, like, a cyberpunk flashback universe or something like mm-hmm. that.
Yeah.
And that was the original Ghost in the Shell. The movies and the anime had that, and looking at this, you can look at it and say, this looks like Ghost in the Shell.
Yeah, I also, right at the beginning, I really liked those, like, geisha robot things. I thought they looked really cool. And I remember seeing, like, some clip of those, like, online before. And, like, they actually, like, fully made those, like, masks, like, work.
Mm-hmm.
Well, not fully. Like, there is some CGI to it. But they actually, like, somewhat made them. So you can definitely see, like, the practical effects in some things. But for the most part, it's just straight up.
Yeah, like, the animatronics there were great.
Yeah, for sure.
I wanted to see more of that.
Mm-hmm. How about the fight scenes, like, in general? What do you guys think?
Not good.
Nope.
Nope.
That spider tank fight scene?
Yeah, there were a lot of bad things about that scene, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. Not just the fight scene itself, but, like, everything behind it didn't make sense.
Yep.
And the coincidences of, like,
yeah,
and stuff like that.
They definitely lifted, almost scene by scene, a lot of shots. And it wasn't just from the first movie, but it was primarily from the first movie.
Yeah.
They also took a bunch of elements, obviously, when you're doing, like, a reboot for such a famous series, you'd want to do that.
Yeah.
But some of them didn't work very well.
Yeah.
So the fight scenes, I feel like you were talking about how Ghost in the Shell, the city felt. The fight scenes did not feel Ghost in the Shell at all. They were, like, the farthest thing from it.
Like, the closest the fight scenes got to capturing the original was the shot-for-shot take of the water fight.
Yeah. Oh,
and
right.
That was great. The anime did have a bit more fluidity to the motion, where, like, the guy's swinging through the air and then his wrist and his legs crack and break.
Yeah.
They didn't have that in this.
There's a lot less violence.
It was like, it was just less motion in the fight scenes, mm-hmm. and that kind of killed some of the fights for me. But I can't say they were horrible. They weren't that bad.
I felt
there
like
there
was
a lot more fighting than Power Rangers had.
That's for sure.
I felt like it was watching, like, a self-driving car, though. I felt like it was less of an actual, like, creature that had thoughts of its own in the fight scenes. It was more like a ballistics report, like, all the time for everything, like, exact shots.
Like a stiff beat-em-up.
Yeah, like, not, I didn't like it.
Yeah.
Taylor, what did you think of these action scenes, considering the first time for you?
You know, I actually, the first action scene when they're telling Major not to go in, and she goes in, and she's shooting through the glass. She goes in. I'm like, you don't see her yet, but she's shooting through the glass, and she's picking off these guys. I'm like, this is dope. I'm getting in on this. This is so cool. And she jumps through, and she's coming in from being cloaked, and she's just going to town on these thugs. I'm thinking, this is actually really cool. And that, like, set the bar really high for me. And then I can't remember what the next fight scene was after that, but the water fight scene was actually really, really cool. I did like that. And when they were in the Yakuza bar or whatever.
Yeah, the club. Yeah.
Yeah, the club.
Yeah.
That was pretty cool. So, I mean, I didn't have any real beefs with any of the fight scenes. I mean, it's probably because I didn't really know what to expect or compare it to, in a sense.
I think, for me, it was just a, like, spider tank fight scene that kind of threw it off. And it kind of sucks that that's, like, the final fight. Mm-hmm. And then the movie ends, like, pretty soon after that, within, like, 10 minutes of that. So yeah. I think it kind of, like, hampers it. But overall, like, the action was decent overall.
I
like,
think that scene the with movie. The spider tank was only there to allude to the original, because that's how the original ended.
That's, yeah, that, I feel like it was definitely, I feel like there were some things that didn't really make sense to be there, but they just popped them in there for the fans.
Yeah, yeah. But also, Taylor, for the first fight scene, what was she standing on while she was shooting for that first 10 seconds? That's the only thing I could think of. I was like,
she didn't have, like, a rope.
Is she flying?
Yeah, no.
Is she, like, is she grabbing something? Because the glass, she's not through it yet.
Yeah.
So is she on a ledge?
Well, that one, that was pretty trippy, first of all. That thing was, like, moving all around. I have no idea what she was saying.
I was just so absorbed in, like, how awesome this first scene is. I didn't really pay attention to that. But, you know, there's a lot of truth to that.
I guess I didn't really think about that. I was kind of wondering, like, I don't really know what's happening. It looks pretty cool. I think they kind of try to trick you sometimes. Like, we don't really know what's going on either, but look how cool that looks, man.
They're hoping the audience wouldn't think too deeply about that.
Just levitating. I feel like it's not so much a cybernetics, like, show at that point. It's like, is that a witch? Is that an actual real-life witch right now flying outside the window? Like, yeah.
What'd you guys think of Scarlett Johansson in general? Because she was, like, on 90% of the shots in this movie. She was all over it, so.
I can only compare her to the original Major,
mm-hmm.
and they really messed with her personality
quite
a lot. She was very angsty. And her acting didn't suit the character either. I almost felt like she would have been better if they had taken the Major's original personality of being more confident and less caring about her past.
Yeah.
And had her just be, like, more, you know, militaristic and all that stuff. Yeah. She would have done that great. She would have had more emotion to show through that. But instead, it was like she was trying to let some emotion seep through, and the director would stop and say, no, 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 act dead.
My fave part was when she saw her mom, and her mom was like, you used to always look at me like that. And I was like, well, fuck, that's the same expression she's been doing the entire movie. So that's awesome, Mom. Like,
that's kind of my problem with it. They clearly wanted it to be, like, you know, a very robotic kind of character.
Yeah.
And, like, her posture and the way she moves around and the way she talks. And, but the result of that was, like, I was just bored when she was on screen. So I can understand the theme, but, like, or, like, message or whatever it is. Mm-hmm. But if that's your main character, it's not very intriguing.
And the original Major wasn't robotic at all.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, she
was,
you know...
That seems like a really weird change.
She seemed very
natural.
But, like, in the...
Yeah, she was fully
like,
a cyborg.
You wouldn't just, like, just looking at her, you wouldn't see any difference between her and a regular person. Whereas, like, this, it just looked like she was uncomfortable. Like, I don't know what it was specifically. It might have been her posture or something.
She was
incredibly uncomfortable.
It was probably
like,
coming
from that,
like,
very
a weird suit she had to wear.
Yeah, it was definitely some, like, prime Hulk Hogan posture mixed with, like, Gerard Way from 2007.
Yeah. And there was, like, a shot from her back, and it looked like she was just, like, standing
like
this the whole
like,
time.
Damn, the Hulkster's on.
Yeah.
I didn't catch on to this at all. I thought she was great. I love Scarlett Johansson. I thought she was awesome in the movie.
The problem with us, though, I mean, at least with those of us who've seen the original movie, is just her personality being changed.
Yeah.
We looked at it more. It really stood out to how different her acting was.
Yeah.
And trying to think of what it could have been. Because when I watch movies like this, I always think, man, they could have done this scene differently. That could have been better.
I want to know, Taylor, what did you like about her character in this movie, then?
I like that she was really trying to feel out her humanity and try to remember and get in touch with that.
Mm-hmm.
It had, for me, this movie had a lot of things to do with, like, iRobot in a sense, where, like, that robot was trying not to, like, see its humanity, but its similarities in that sense where, like, Major was just, she was trying to remember what it's like to be more human than machine, even though it's something she never remembered until near the end of the film. I like that kind of struggle between a machine and human in a story, especially for a synthetic, which when you're combined with both, it's, it makes for an interesting story. And I think she really brought that on. When you say she had that kind of look to her where she was like, she was like offended by some bad joke, and the bad joke came from like someone she knows on a personal level, and it's like, I can kind of see that expression.
Just the whole movie, there's just like someone telling her messages in her head, she's like, that's not funny.
Who was the director of your earpiece? Just, I'm going to just give you puns throughout the entire movie. This is how I want you to act.
That's hilarious. Yeah, I feel like there's only maybe three or four scenes where she's actually like showing emotion too, like in terms of like acting, like the way, like actually moving her face around to show emotion and stuff like that. I don't know. I was not invested in that character very much.
She also had a lot of weird dissonance. She was like a soldier, but she was the worst soldier ever. Like she follows orders, right? So at the start of the movie, Armaki's like, don't jump. She's like, jumps. And then, like, after that, it's like, don't dive into that geisha bot. Dives into geisha bot. And it's like, what is this character? You're trying to make it, like, a military persona.
Yeah.
Where she only follows orders, but she's the worst. Like, she never listens to anything.
Yeah.
So, that, like, the character didn't make a lot of sense in that aspect.
Who else? Let's talk about the Guy Fieri-looking guy with the eye.
I thought they picked a really good actor for him. He looked spot on.
Yeah.
I did enjoy his character with the dogs, especially. Like, they put stuff from the second movie in the anime.
I like that
there.
A lot.
They brought more character to him than what he had in the original movie.
That is true.
And I loved how they built up to, like, his eyes, like, being blown out. But that part I wasn't so happy with, because in the original, his eyes are, like, from the eye sockets. They stick out, right? From back
creepy.
Here.
The skin stretches.
Whenever I saw his face, I was just like, looking at the skin right here. I just, like,
it's like he closed his eyes, and they stitched his eyelids shut, and then put little irises in the center.
Yeah.
Whereas it shouldn't be that way. It should be these mechanical cylinders that come out right from his eye socket, not from the center.
Is that how they have it in, like, every iteration?
Yeah.
Yeah, because it's not disgusting. Like, that looks uncomfortable.
Yeah.
It does look pretty weird.
It's like a soft, bally surface. That's what you're running into in the movie. Why do you want this hard piece of metal resting on a ball surface? You want it to be, like, part of your skull coming
but
out.
But also, like, did they add bone? Like, what is that? What's keeping it there? I poked it, would my finger go through? Like,
it is a little bit that close.
Can you reach behind through the water?
Is that who gets it out?
Just unscrew it or something.
That's nasty. See, I mean, okay, besides that one little flaw, though, I thought Bato was great. He was a great character in this movie, and I almost wanted just to see more of him interacting with the Major, because he was bringing life to the film.
Mm-hmm. He definitely seemed, like, the most real. Like, he seemed the most human.
He was the most like his original self.
He was the only character, in
my
opinion.
Yeah, for sure. That's a fair assessment. I think the only other guy that you could really say is like a big character is the, what's the name of the other like robot guy that she's talking to?
Kosei?
Oh yeah, Kosei.
Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah, he's not named that in any of the iterations.
Oh, okay. I thought he was like a big.
His name is like Puppet Master in the original.
Yeah. Oh, cool.
Yeah.
That's a better name.
Well, let's talk about him then. What do you guys think of him?
Yeah.
No sympathy. Weird character. Like, I felt poorly acted.
Although I enjoyed in towards the end when he was talking to the Major, like in the room for the first time, with like where the center was of the human intelligence network thing.
Okay.
How he was stuttering a lot and like his voice was like very disconnected from his body. Mm-hmm. That was a cool effect, but I mean that doesn't really do anything for his character.
Yeah, that didn't take me out of the fact where I was like, okay, hold up. They're making a network out of brains? What does that mean? Why would I want to join a network of brains?
I think the point was that was the most powerful part of their system. You wouldn't go to a computer to build a network. You'd want the most powerful thing you can find, and that would be one of those cyber brains.
Mm-hmm.
So get a bunch of them linked together, strip away the humanity, or their ghost, I guess. And you've got this amazing interface with, like, the best computer in the world is 20 humans linked together. But that's a lot of subtext to read
into. That also gives me so many more questions. Like, a lot.
I guess.
What do you think of his look? He's like animatronic.
He looked like he was out of Final Fantasy. Yeah, like those 3D Final Fantasy movies where he's like walking around. It's like, ooh, nope. He didn't look good.
I don't know. He looked like he was intentionally in poor repair.
Intentionally.
I feel like the technology is there for him to have a bit of a better body.
You would think. It seems like he has a lot of people helping him out.
But also, like, Mega Hacker still lives in a tin can body. Like, can he do something to fix that?
Yeah.
Like, a little bit. Maybe get rid of the stutter.
I mean, he has time to get a tattoo on his
legs.
But at the same time, he didn't seem to care because he wanted to be uploaded to the network. So maybe he was like, oh, I'm getting rid of this body. But
do we know that? Because I actually feel like that didn't happen in that movie. I think they totally removed that element of the story, which was such a huge part of the original movie. I think they totally removed that. So the puppet master in the original one, he is a being that can live without a body. He has his mind, and he can like basically export it into various like bodies.
Yeah.
So that's really important when the question and the main theme of like the movie is, what is humanity when you don't need a body and you can still have independent thoughts and you can upload yourself to other things? So what I think they were trying was, with the brain network, they were trying to say that he was uploading himself to that network, which he said in that scene.
Mm-hmm.
But at the end, he very explicitly was like, I'll always be with your ghost in your memory. Which totally...
Wait, did he said in her memory?
I'm fairly certain he said memory.
I only heard the ghost bit. I don't know for sure.
I don't
remember
the memory part.
It's still... Even with this, so even if he didn't say memory, how vague is that? That he's... Yeah, they invoked the last scene of the first movie, but they also took away all of the elements that made it really powerful.
Mm-hmm.
So it was just some dude lying on the ground that got sniped. You know what I'm saying? Like,
his eyes shut off. Like, it kind of looked like he did finish his little upload thing there. I was like, oh, hey, you know, I'm not even here.
It was sort of implied, but
it was quick.
Yeah, the case for it happening versus it not happening, like, so vague.
Yeah.
So what was his purpose in this movie? Like, was he trying to convert Scarlett Johansson's character? Like, what was he trying to do?
He was just trying to get revenge on Honka Robotics there.
Yeah.
By what, like, destroying them all or something?
Yeah, he...
Like, killing the people who made him, I guess.
Yeah, he broke in and he stole that list of all of his creators and he started, like, killing them.
Yeah, he was basically like, I never asked for this. Yep. And then just went Adam Jensen on everyone.
And then I guess Scarlett Johansson's character, like, picks up on what he's doing because of the memories, because of their connection somehow.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Because, I mean, they did to her what they did to him.
Yeah.
But they did it better.
Yeah.
So that she didn't realize. And then he, like, basically told her the truth. And then she's like, well, you guys are kind of dicks, but I'm not going to do anything about it.
Yeah, with the weirdest scene choice of her shooting him and then running up to him and saying, where'd you get that tattoo? Like, okay. Yeah.
Nice. To be fair, that's his one human part. I guess he has, like, kind of a face, but, you know, that's pretty distinct.
You see that hair?
Okay, that hair.
Wow.
Yeah, I don't know. What did you guys think of that scene? Because to me, I don't know, I felt like that change was a little sudden, maybe, for her to just go AWOL. But then she kind of, I guess she didn't go fully AWOL. She still teamed up with her old pals. I don't know. I felt like that change didn't make a whole lot of sense to me.
I don't feel like the Major would ever go AWOL. It was just she was trying to escape the company that made her, but not Section 9. But to escape them completely for now, to like find out what's going on, she had to shut herself off from both of them and then come back later. Although I'm not sure what her intentions were, to just disappear underwater for a while and then come back up to the boat and be like, oh, hey, Batso, you're not here to take me back, are you? Oh, I trust you.
Another bizarre choice of just ripping almost scene from scene. This one was a little different from the original.
The water?
Yes. Because the idea in the original was that she was basically tempting fate because she's full-on cybernetic, so if something went wrong with her wetsuit, she might die, and she got to discuss humanity with Bato a little bit more after that in the original. But then in this one, it's like, I hate my creators. I'm going to go diving. Like,
So it feels real.
Yeah.
Interesting. What other characters? What was her name? Dr. Ouellette?
Ouellette.
I could not stand her at all. Every time she was on, that was the character I was talking about earlier.
I kept forgetting she existed.
Yeah, I just, every time she was on screen, I was like, why does this character exist?
I definitely forgot about her at the end of the film until you brought up the fact that you were happy that she died.
I was so happy that she died. I couldn't stand her.
She was only there to let the Major escape.
Yeah,
that was it.
Pretty much.
They had to think, how are we going to make the Major escape? Someone needs to be on her side in this facility.
Mm-hmm.
And then they made a character and said, okay, we need an actor for this. For what? For this idea. We don't need a script. We don't need a character or personality. We just need a plot device that's acted by a person.
To be fair, after they said all that, they were like, French? And then they found a French actor, because apparently that mattered a ton.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Interesting.
But that character I also felt like was very heavy-handed in what I thought was the director's way of trying to push a moral, because she was like basically a mother figure.
Yep.
To I already forget what the Major's first name in the series.
Mira or something.
Yeah, like whatever, her mom, and every single time she kept like doting and reassuring that she was human and everything like that, and I was like, oh my god, I get it. Like, by the second time she was on screen, I was like, enough!
Yeah.
Yep.
Interesting. What other characters? Any other characters?
Aramaki.
Yes.
Who's that?
He was the old guy with the little wily exactly. hair.
The fox.
Oh, yes. Yeah. The guy with the crazy hair.
Yeah, yes. Like,
I think Haley loves this guy. Why do you love this guy?
Okay. I don't know. I just got a good vibe from him. As soon as I saw him, like, this guy knows what's going on. And when
he's old and he's Japanese.
Yeah, you know, I thought, okay, he's on the comm right now with Major, and Cutter, the bad dude's listening in, and I thought, oh no, this old guy's gonna get popped. I don't want to see this happen. Cutter just listened to the whole conversation. I see him, and he's walking so feebly. I think he's just setting the stage. He's alone in the parking lot, it's dark, thinking, oh, for crying out loud, I don't want to see this. And he's walking. He almost needs his walker to get into the car, but he gets in. And then you can see the other enemy car pull up. I'm thinking, oh, here we go. But he doesn't die. He ducks, and he gets up, and he guns all of them down and pops that awesome line off. And I'm thinking, this guy is a legend.
He invokes Miyagi from The Karate Kid for like half a second.
I felt like that. Like,
I think that scene was really good. Throughout the rest of the movie, his character was never explored because he's just like the leader, right?
Mm-hmm.
But the actor that portrayed him, I like that he was speaking in Japanese because like everyone can just understand that now because of their enhancements and all this.
Right.
So that was kind of a cool addition. I think he was just dubbed in the English version, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, because I only ever watched it in Japanese. But yeah. In this movie, having him speak in Japanese, that was cool. I almost wish there were more people speaking in different languages to really push that atmosphere of what this world is like. But Aramaki was the only one that did that.
Yeah, they could have done that at the start with those like all those businessmen at the table in the first
scene. Yeah, all those different languages, or like walking through the bar and just hearing the chatter of different people not talking the same language.
Mm-hmm.
But then with Aramaki doing his little fight scene there, he pulls out the gun. Man, that was cool. I kind of like that addition, as cheesy as it was. I thought for a second there that he just flat out died. I had that beat where I'm like,
yeah, really?
Did they?
I clearly saw him like move down before they started shooting. So I was like, he's alive.
But I missed that part.
Also, as someone that's seen all of the media, weren't you like, oh, there's no way. there's no way he's gonna die.
I'm like, maybe they just knew they wouldn't be able to afford a sequel. So.
Oh, thank God. Like, honestly, Aramaki's character. Totally not at all similar to any other iteration of Ghost in the Shell, because he was a weird, reserved, like, spirit guide character, whereas in the other, like, iterations of Ghost in the Shell, he's this, like, super sly, super, like, politically minded, very intelligent, very fast-thinking guy, who's, like he'll fix a problem, no problem. Cool. But in this, he was just, like, your grandpa, but also he's got a gun.
He was incredibly generic.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
They gave him a fight scene, they made him the leader guy, and that was kind of it.
Yeah.
Although I can't say he was ever my favorite character in the anime, because of his just stoic, political, I'm the leader. Again, he had more personality to him in the anime, but it never really stood out to me. So in this movie, I feel like I almost didn't really notice the change. I was like, hey, he says less now.
It was pretty close in my opinion. Mm-hmm.
What is the name of the other villain guy?
Cutter? How could you
Cutter? Forget? Yes. Yeah. Very basic name. Yep. I can't remember anyone's name from this movie, pretty much. What did you guys think of Cutter?
Who?
Cutter.
They could have cut him right now.
Yeah. They could have cut him. Honestly, right. Like, that character was meant to replace, like, the Minister of Home Affairs, but only sort of. Yeah. But it didn't
but he's
work.
The, he's supposed to be, like, the climax of the film. He dies and all is well, kind of.
Well, he wasn't horrible.
I felt like he was horrible.
I feel like there wasn't enough stuff for him to do.
Yeah, yeah. He didn't do anything.
Everyone's looking at me. Stop
I don't know what to think about him. He did nothing. He approved an experiment, and then everyone hates him.
Yeah, and it went wrong, and he's like, we're not doing the experiment anymore, guys.
Can you imagine if at the end, after his little speech about how he wanted us to strip away the humanity from the Major, oh, well, they don't need this. If at the end, he was scared and just committed suicide, just to really pull that humanity back out to the forefront of how easy it is to change a person, that might have added something to it. And I was almost expecting him to do that before Aramaki just shot him.
Yeah.
I wouldn't have minded that, but, like, still...
It would have made it worse.
He's literally one of the more sympathetic characters in the show, and that's not that great if that's the villain. Like.
I don't know. What do you guys think about just the story overall, then? Like, compared to... Obviously, we talked about the characters, but, like...
Let's take...
I want to know, like...
The original story from the movie, and then take elements from everything else, put it in a mixing bowl, like mashed potatoes and gravy, and add some mud to it, and try to make it as unclear as possible. But because it's so unclear, we're going to outright state the themes in the very beginning. You have this spirit, a ghost, in the shell. Do you get it yet?
There were a lot of points like that that had me chuckling, because I was like, what?
It was so,
like, Frankenstein, like, back alley abortion story. Like, they took, like, parts and elements from really odd spots in the first movie, and then they were also like, a dog. Do you remember the lady that smoked in that one episode, a standalone complex? Well, she's in this too. She was a direct, like, copy paste from, like, literally one episode in the animated series.
Mm-hmm. I feel like what they did with the whole Motoko name thing too, like, they didn't even need to state that. They didn't have to go that far to...
I felt like that was a big middle finger to the people saying that the character was whitewashed. Mm. That's why I felt like that was in there. Because having that scene in, you can't make the argument for Scarlett Johansson being a whitewashed character anymore.
Right. Yeah.
Well, I mean, if you could just easily switch bodies like that, and this group that's making androids wants to make whatever they want, they can change up a person's look however. Like, you don't have a choice in the matter.
Oh, no, you're totally right.
Right?
Yeah.
But...
Like, I thought that was... The people... Outside the whitewashing thing, I thought, oh, okay, you know, I can understand that. That's kind of a cool inclusion. But, whatever. I don't know. I remember reading before this movie came out that when they had actors applying for the film, there was a certain point where they stopped accepting Japanese people. And there was, like, people, like, applying for some of the main characters, like, oh, you're Japanese? No, no, we can't have any more Japanese. Turning down their resumes and their auditions.
Really?
Yeah.
That's yeah, because Togusa got such a prime spot.
I know, right? He was one of my favorite characters in the anime, and in Innocence and stuff, and then he got maybe 5 lines, and his entire character was like, I'm 100% human.
Yeah, which...
Is that the other guy in the, like, Assassin's group or whatever it is?
Section 9.
He was the guy. Wait, was he the guy who was the sniper at the end who shot down the helicopter?
Yeah, that was. No, that wasn't him. That was Saito. That was who I don't even remember from anything.
He was in the anime.
I don't remember him.
I don't even remember the scene earlier in the movie.
No, that was his first scene.
Pretty sure he was in Standalone Complex and then more prevalent in the second season.
Yeah,
he was always a sniper. He was in the helicopter all the time.
He has a good shot.
He was always shooting. That was his character in the anime. Was I'm the sniper.
We need a character that shoots planes.
So they put him there. And then Togusa just got shafted really hard. Although he wasn't prevalent in the original movie either. It was Innocence where he kind of came out as having a character.
Right? Okay, so
I think I do.
Do you remember the dude in the restaurant when Section 9 got that burn notice? And he was just eating, and he sees the dude in the mirror, and he shoots him really fast. That was Togusa.
Japanese guy with the accent. He had the greasy black hair going
down. I think
I do
know.
Almost mullet length.
Remember when there was the red hologram, and he's like detailing it, and he puts his coffee mug on the ground, and he's explaining to the old Asian guy what's going on.
Nope.
Okay. Yeah. I was gonna bring up that scene too, but I'm like, don't talk about it.
I'm pretty sure. No point. I'm pretty sure I know what you're talking about, but I don't. Yeah, I feel like he had like one or two.
He was almost like a bootleg Jackie Chan.
One thing that really bothered me about the scene where they were getting burned was, like, it sounded like his gun was a silencer, but then it was just like a revolver with no, like, nothing on the end. I'm like, what?
You know, dude, it's the future.
That revolver was sick. I think one of my big problems with the story, like, you know that speech they have right at the end of the movie before she takes, like, that another jump off the building? Whatever that speech was, like, they had the exact same one, like, earlier in the movie.
It was, our memories don't define us, what we do defines us.
That was my fave one.
They had to push the themes that hard.
Yeah, right?
I know, that's why, like, it doesn't, like, really make you think at all, because it just kind of...
That's what the original movies do.
Like, it tells you exactly what it wants you to think.
The original movies were like, you need to think about
it. And it tells you twice. Word for word, it tells you twice.
There's definitely a couple lines in there where they, like, repeated it just for the sake of repeating it.
Yeah.
Like, when they were making
this movie. Like, hire new writers.
No. That line, though, our memories don't define us, our actions do. I was like, well, how do you remember them?
Yeah.
Like, do you just immediately be like, well, glad that shit's done, take that out, please? Like...
That's what I was thinking too. Like, that doesn't even really make
that
much sense.
Yeah, it doesn't make any sense. And the biggest problem I think that this movie has in terms of comparisons to, like, past works is that it totally bastardizes the main ideas. It, at the end of the movie, it kind of seems like the Major is against technology, which is totally not at all anything to do with Ghost in the Shell. That is not the right series if you want to push that message. Because the main one, like, the main movie in 1995 was all about how technology is advancing. There's nothing you can do about that, so why even talk about if it's bad or good? It was more about where does humanity fit in with technology. It wasn't saying, humanity good, technology bad.
Yeah.
Thanks, Smash. Like, yeah, okay. Nice. You just jumped off a building and you went invisible. Yeah, technology really sucks. Like...
I think that's the biggest flaw this movie has,
is
it ruined Ghost in the Shell's themes, and it had to state the themes it did have outright to the audience to take away any subtext there.
You don't have to think about it at all.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, it was just, let's watch flashy action,
Scarlett
Johansson, and
awkward movements.
And sometimes really bright, like, strobe lights you can't even really watch.
Oh, that scene was so bad.
Like, two or three of them.
That was, but, like, specifically the flashlight fight scene. I can't even imagine make someone think that was a good idea. Let's just make everybody with epilepsy die.
I know, that's what I was thinking. Like, that's scary.
We watched the movie in 3D though, and I remember the strobe light being the worst part. The flashlights though, that didn't really.
Really?
That. Did they tone that down for 3D, or...?
I know, I forgot about that, but my head's, hurting right now, remembering.
Like, the first part, are you talking about?
Yeah.
Like, the start of the movie? When there's all those lights?
The
strobe light
cloud.
At the beginning is what I remember hurting my eyes a little bit.
Yeah.
But any other fight scenes or flashlights and stuff like that, like, that didn't stand out. I don't remember it.
I for sure closed my eyes at the flashlight.
It was, like, the very beginning when she was, like, getting initialized or whatever. It was really bright. Then there was, the strobe light in the Yakuza thing. And there was even, like, it was just a short, like, 2 or 3 second clip, like, in the spider tank fight where, I don't know, for me, it was just something really fucking annoying.
You know,
I
think the theater we were watching it in, I remember the lights didn't seem to dim all the way.
Mm.
So it wasn't
maybe
completely
they
pitch black around
saved,
you.
Yeah.
I think it saved us.
You should send an email to the theater and let them know.
Keep the lights like that for this movie in particular. If you don't want people going blind or getting eye cancer, just keep it like this.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Any other points?
Spider mech looked cool.
It did.
At least. I mean, like, I got
it was pretty dumb.
Mm-hmm.
I guess it was a guy controlling it. That guy was pretty dumb.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Why was he controlling it?
Some agency in the story.
All of a sudden,
don't take this
time
from
time.
Him.
All of a sudden, it was very personal for him.
Yeah.
Why?
I want to do the aiming. Well, I think during the spider tank fight, though, the original movie kind of freaked me out when the Major was pulling apart the tank.
Oh,
and
I loved that scene. That was my second favorite scene in this movie, too.
Yeah, like, they captured
awesome.
It.
Yeah.
But they didn't go out to the point where, like, her body's, like, bulging, so muscular, she looks like something out of a Marvel comic.
Mm-hmm.
I almost like how they kind of kept her a little bit more feminine for that, but still showed all this muscle tone and then her back ripping up. Like, ooh, hey, that's neat. I like that they kept it in there, but just they toned it down right.
Taylor, like that. What'd you like about that?
Your reaction. Whoa, that's neat. I can just picture her like abs and her back like stretching apart. Like
yeah.
It was, there was a lot of cringing moments for me.
It was a little gross, but it was very, it was a very cool scene.
The gross scenes were good enough for the atmosphere, though. Like the, like you said, you didn't like the girl when the geisha went in expire mode.
No,
that back was up the wall, on the table.
Yeah,
like that was creepy.
It was a little unnerving, but
that,
I mean,
I liked that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. It was freaky and it fit with like the hacking and how distorted these things could get for like just moving around.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I thought those things were very cool.
One thing that I really liked was when those thugs at the start too in the scene, they had like those visors on. And then one of them gets the visor ripped out, and they don't even have like any eyes behind it. It's just like these cores that like get ripped out of their eye sockets. That looked really cool.
That was weird, though.
That's pretty gruesome, right there.
There's the one lady with the cigarettes, of course. Her little eyelid things go up,
and that like, startled me. I was like, what the fuck?
You can see the actor like trying not
to. I was like, what?
Like, okay, well, yeah, the original did that, but they kind of slid up a little differently, mm-hmm. and the eyes weren't really there.
And when that thing got taken off by Kosei, I was like, did that really cause you that much pain? Because, I mean, like, what's the difference between you, like, ejecting this part of your face and someone taking it off of your face? That character shouldn't have been in this, but, oh.
It seems weird that that character was kind of, like, an actual character from the original.
She was a likable character in the original one, because she was this kind of, like...
Was she, like, more important in...
No, she was only in it for, like, what, one scene? The first standalone Complex season. And she was just this, like, badass old woman that was examining this, like, body to see what was up.
Yeah, like, you looked at her and you go, oh, hey, this is an interesting character. They don't explore her personality. She doesn't have development. But the way that they portrayed her and showed her in the scenes and just her, like, confidence, you know? It was like, oh, she has a job here, right?
I think she's a character from the manga. That is my guess, because I think that would make the most sense, because she was a fully realized character in just that one episode, which is pretty hard to do, usually.
Mm-hmm.
So I feel like...
I wouldn't put it past them, though, if she's not from the manga. They just took her out of one episode. I don't know. I mean...
Are we really going to give that much credit?
Yeah, do you guys have any other points? Any other things you want to bring up?
I've already stressed most of my flaws in this movie. I mean, it's all about the thematic elements.
My other stuff was just, like, petty, like, why'd you do this?
Yeah. Those are the things that really ruined the film for me, and how muddy they made the plot.
Mm-hmm.
The acting was not fitting.
I mean, like, it was non-existent, so...
Yeah, but
it was a shell of its former self.
Oh, yeah. You know, not knowing anything about this movie, from watching the trailer, I thought that Bato, the Guy Fieri-looking guy, was the villain. I don't know why, but that's just what I picked up. And when I went into the show and saw, okay, he's actually good, I like him. So who's the bad guy? Oh, it's this Kusei guy? This other robot? I'm like, okay, he's the villain. I'm catching along here. No, he's not the villain. Oh, it's Cutter, the guy that had one scene at the very beginning of the film? Okay.
Yeah, but he has a different color eye, so...
He does have a different color eye.
That's an evil name.
Yeah, like, actually...
Like, Cutler? You know, that's a fine name. Cutter? Whoa. That actually gets a lot more aggressive.
I have one thing I can bring up. It doesn't really relate to the film, it relates to the marketing. I don't know if you've seen the marketing for it, but... The people that made this movie were putting it on magazine covers, and one of their taglines for it, like everywhere, was the next gen Matrix. And you know what? What? Because if you go back to the Matrix, the directors and the authors for the Matrix were like, we were inspired by Ghost in the Shell. So we've just come full circle now. That really pissed me off.
And isn't there a Matrix like reboot in the works too? That's gonna
inspire Ghost in the Shell.
Inspired by Ghost in the Shell
2017. I think Ghost in the Shell 2. I don't think it's gonna happen. This movie had a pretty bad opening weekend, apparently.
I mean, it's an action film though, so it'll probably make all of its money back and then some in the international market.
Yeah, for sure.
And diehard fans will still enjoy the visuals and buy it later too.
Oh, they were great.
Mm-hmm.
They were pretty good. Any other points, or should we get to the final ratings?
I got nothing else.
Taylor, you seem like there's something brewing.
I mean,
just say it.
I had no interest in seeing this movie. Like, I wouldn't have gone to see it. Like, but you know, Reuben
I dragged you there.
He wanted to see it. I'm like, you know, I'm gonna go along with Reuben, go see this.
And sure, Reuben's like, I want to do a review.
Yeah, I'm gonna jump in for a review too.
I want to take this chair.
and you know, wasn't all that bad. It could have been worse. I mean, I'm happy to know that a lot of people don't.
This is gonna be bad.
This is Taylor saying the movie is bad, Nicole.
Well, I'm not sure I'm saying it's bad, but you know, I mean, it could have been worse. It had some.
It could have been worse. I definitely agree. Yeah.
At least you and I have really bad movies to compare it to for ratings.
Yeah,
really, really bad.
I've seen some worse.
Dylan has some bad movies.
Netflix and Fail. We watch a lot of really shit movies. So I've seen movies.
Do you think, in your opinion, do you think this is one for that could have made the roster for Netflix and Fail?
You know, that I would have to think about. Yeah. I don't know. I gotta think about that. Well, because what makes the roster is its rating on Netflix. So if it was less than 2-3 stars on Netflix, I mean, it's eligible for the show.
When Travis is Netflix, I'm sure this movie would have been rated qualifying enough.
It's I don't know, it's hard to say, because it's nice to look at. Like, there is positives in this movie. It's not all just shit. Like, there is some good stuff in there, so... I don't know. Ratings? Yep. Ratings, everyone?
Yeah.
Let's start with Tyler.
Oh, gosh.
We don't have to start with you if you don't want to. We can come back to you.
Sure, yeah.
Let's start with... Reuben.
5.5 out of 10.
5.5 out of 10?
It was okay. And, I mean, anything above 3 is usually enjoyable for me.
Hmm.
My scale's a little different.
Mm.
I don't like making everything up in the high ratings here. Like, I have my masterpieces, I have my 9 out of 10s, my 8 out of 10s. And those are all amazing films for me. And then 6 and 5 are usually the mediocre, I'd watch it again. Yeah. No, it's not horrible. 4 is, I didn't really enjoy it on a personal level. And then below that, like 3... That movie wasn't great, it had major flaws. 2 is that movie was shit. And 1 is that movie is The Room. So that's my scale. 5.5.
So it can't get any lower than The Room. Interesting. Taylor.
Oh, okay.
I kind of want to see The Room now. Just to, like, know your skills.
You have called classic.
God.
It's bad.
Oh my god.
Anyways.
If Taylor's saying it's bad,
it's really bad.
Wait, whoa. Those are two different things. There's a difference between bad and good bad. Some movies are really bad that they're good. Some movies are just really bad.
This is both.
That they're just bad.
It's entirely possible that this movie we're talking about, it's a cult classic because it goes beyond so bad it's good. It's so bad. It's disgustingly bad.
The history of how it was released is also a crucial factor.
Reading the book is just an amazing insight to humanity.
To humanity.
Yes.
Tommy Wiseau.
Should have
alerted to that in Ghost.
There's a ghost in the shell in Tommy Wiseau. But, okay. Let's get back to the
I'm going to give it a 7.5. You know. And I'm giving one of my realistic ratings.
So,
is this the realistic rating? Where is Suicide Squad on this rating scale?
If I was comparing Ghost in the Shell to Suicide Squad, I give Suicide Squad a 9 and Ghost in the Shell a 6.
Oh.
Travis is gonna fucking...
Your rating system just has no rhyme, no reason to. Also, I'd like to remind you that you gave Assassin's Creed a 7.
Yes, and I was giving my legit...
So is this better than Assassin's Creed?
No.
There you go, people. Taylor's rating system.
Definitely not.
How does this compare to Power Rangers, which we just saw together?
I thoroughly enjoyed Power Rangers more. It had that nostalgia, and not that I was comparing, but I mean, like, a lot of things just seemed more... It was more enjoyable, things made sense, and just its scenes were more...
Okay, yeah. No, I can actually see Power Rangers making more sense than this movie.
Yeah.
I'll fly with
that. It's a lot simpler.
I mean... This,
it actually makes sense.
Ghost in the Shell, like, it made sense at times, but I mean, at the same time, like I said at the beginning of the cast, I was confused, but I wasn't, and I don't know if it was the lights doing something to me.
There were some weird lights.
There were some trippy lights. But, you know, it could have been worse, but it wasn't bad, and I liked it. I'll definitely watch it again. I definitely maybe won't buy it.
I think you're
just saying every single possible
outcome. Yeah, I feel like just to be safe, you're putting every emotion on the line, every possibility. You can just pick and choose.
That's where I'm at.
That's all. That's okay, all.
Okay. Definitely won't buy it until it's expensively cheap.
Yeah.
Mccall? This one's a 3 for me.
A 3?
Yeah, this is definitely a 3. If you want to see a Ghost in the Shell movie, just go watch the 1995 one. Like, it's great. The reason why it's a 3 is because that story was so bad, and in and of itself, if you didn't see any of the other Ghosts in the Shells, you wouldn't have understood, like, how comlinks worked and how, like, hacking and diving even worked or what they even were, because it just looked like magic. Where you get attacked by zombies. So I feel like giving it its own, like, just looking at itself and not including anything from the other movies, it was terrible. Mm-hmm. The visuals were really awesome, but those can't save a story that is so bad it needs to repeat to you what's happening every, like, 15 minutes.
Yeah, definitely. 3. Are you ready, Tyler?
Like a mediocre 4 for me.
A mediocre 4?
Yeah. Like a scribbled 4 and like a child wrote down the 4 in like blue crayon or something. But the crayon
that's Taylor's favorite color.
But the crayon broke like as they were finishing the final line, so they had to like get a yellow crayon and finish it. And it just looked awful.
And that's a mediocre 4 to you. Wouldn't that be like an awful 4? That sounds like a not good 4.
There can be worse 4s.
The worst is when the child draws on the wall with their poo and it's a 4.
That's pretty bad. We'll get there when we get there.
We'll get there. No, I don't think we ever want to get there.
Yeah, no, there's just, like, so much wrong with it. Like, the acting and the story, like, I would, honestly, the acting, like, made it worse for me than the story. Yeah. Because it just looked, like, everyone was so uncomfortable with what they were doing. And nothing looked natural. Mm-hmm. And I feel like they kind of wanted that to happen, but it just looked awful. And then just, like, I don't know. Story just like not there, and then the only thing I had going for it was lots of money thrown at the visuals, and yeah, it was pretty cool looking, but that's about it.
Yeah, I think that's a good point with the acting. I think some movies, you know, it's a script, and like, you know, an actor really can't do much with the script. There's just no material there to really work off of. This movie, it seemed like a combination. Maybe it wasn't necessarily like the acting or the actor's fault, but like the directing of the acting. But it was just so boring, and so that's, yeah, for me, this movie was just not very good. Like, the story had me, like, clipped in for, like, 15 or 20 minutes, and then the rest of it was just, like, really boring. The only thing I really had going for it was that it looked really interesting and, like, unique, and it just looked, like, really good. Like, I thought the CGI, I think you guys, like, disliked the CGI more than I did. I thought it was, like, pretty good. Like, I only had a couple minor issues with it, but, as all you all know, I don't use the number system anymore, so you know how, if you listen to this review, you know how I feel about this movie. And I don't think I'll ever see this again. I definitely, in the next few days, I'm going to go watch the original, because sounds like an actual good time.
Yeah.
And maybe I'll learn something about myself, you know, watching that movie. That's what it sounds like. It sounds like a very good learning experience. So, Taylor, where do you think they can find us?
I think that if they go into the deep dive web.
The deep dive web?
There you go. Sure. You know.
No.
That's not how it works at all, but we'll allow it.
Don't give them a there you go.
Don't encourage them.
In the search bar, you want to type in on your Facebook.
Oh, it's like, remember that one scene in the movie when the girls like playing the piano?
That scared the crap out of me.
That's what you gotta do to find
They only had that in there because it was in the anime. Yeah.
Yeah, it's so good though. Not in that scene.
That freaked me out.
So do that.
Yeah, and type in your Facebook, and in the search bar, you got to type in Geekverse Space Podcast. There's an awesome profile picture with an even awesomer cover photo, and tons of even awesomer links and posts and awesome stuff that lead to more awesome content supplied to you by Geekverse, which also has stuff on
Geekverse Cast.
Yes.
Is on. That's our Twitter, Geekverse Cast. Everywhere else is just Geekverse Podcast. That's Twitch and YouTube and iTunes and Stitcher Radio and Google Play and SoundCloud, I think I mentioned that. We're also on Reddit, even though no one really posts on there. But, you know, come check us out. Come have a conversation. We're also on Patreon. Definitely check us out on Patreon. If you, even if you just drop down $1, you get access to a bunch of casts early. You can ask us a question that we'll answer live on probably next week newscast, I imagine. Or
I would think
next week or the week after. So that'll be that. And yes, thanks for tuning in, and Geekverse out.
Have a good night.
See you in the search bar.